And this session will be chaired by Roberto Schaeffer, and it will be a session about aligning oil developments and climate change mitigation goals. Roberto, I'll hand the floor to you.
Okay, good afternoon. My name is Roberto Schaeffer. I'm a professor of energy planning at the Federal University of Rio in Brazil. And I have been working with energy issues for almost 25 years now, and with climate issues for almost 20 years by now with the IPCC. And somehow I have been able to, let's say, to work with these two communities, the energy community and the climate change community. And sometimes I notice that these two communities do not talk with each other. And somehow I noticed this during these 2 days here, because sometimes we have different speeches that we're speaking. And I think the good thing about this session is exactly about that, because the name of the session, as Aro said, is Aligning Oil Development and Climate Change Mitigation Goals. So somehow, since we are very close to the end of this meeting, it's good to have a session where we try to align, let's say, fossil fuel development and climate change mitigation options. The first speaker is going to be Mark Jaccard. He's from the Simon Fraser University in Canada. So I'm going to ask each presenter to stick with the 10 minutes for two reasons. One is because I noticed that some people attending the meeting are not very happy for not having enough time to raise issues and for discussions, and also because I have to catch a plane right after this session. So I have two very good reasons to keep the 10 minutes very strict. So Mark, you have the floor, please.
All right, flip my watch here. You'll warn me too. Thank you. So I'll be talking about fossil fuel project approvals and climate commitments, and my talk is called Modeling Tools for Connecting the Dots. So I'm addressing the rationale that a given fossil fuel project is consistent with 2C, right? And President Obama said, we're not approving the Keystone XL pipeline if it significantly increases greenhouse gases. So there you had a case where we were looking at a fossil fuel infrastructure investment, and we actually had political leaders saying, I need to know what is going to be the impact of that particular investment. And of course, the fossil fuel industry and its allies said, well, listen, this project is consistent with 2 degrees. They have a lot of different rationales, and in my paper, I talk about the other rationales, but here, I'm just focused on the idea that an individual project can be. A clever economist will claim it's consistent with 2C. And as I say, regulators and governments assessing, and in the case study I'm going to use, I'm going to say that this can apply to other fossil fuel projects. And in fact, we're using something like this for looking at a coal port expansion project. But I'm going to focus on the Alberta oil sands and the pipelines to the Alberta oil sands, because that is such a huge issue in North America. So climate and climate lobbyists are obviously interested in this claim about, is this project consistent with 2C, especially for these long-lived infrastructure projects. So I'm going to start with the unconnected dots. The climate Earth models estimate the carbon budget for 2C. And then this carbon budget is what is used by, I'll call them global energy economy emissions models, to estimate the 2C path for the carbon price and for fossil fuel demand. So we saw that we've seen it in various talks here, but even the opening talk of Paul Ekins put up a slide, I believe, of the carbon price trajectory. And but most of these models don't give you a real world oil, don't try to give you a real world oil price. There's an optimization aspect to these models. And so they have, we might call them, economists might call them shadow prices. But when I talk to them and say, okay, but what will be the oil price? Because we really need to know that for 10 years, 20 years from now. And well, as I'll show you, a doctoral student of mine interviewed a lot of modelers, and we couldn't quite get the answers we wanted. So we're interested in doing that in order to check these claims of consistency with the climate goals. So from that, we built an oil price determination model, and I'm an energy economist, and for years, I'd have to say decades, I've been a reviewer of papers and journals and reading about, of course, the oil price. And so, but I haven't really written on this area. So I got together some colleagues that are well known in this field, and I said to them, come on, well, how would we build an oil price determination model, taking information from these energy economy emissions models? So what we're going to do is get from them the 2 degrees Celsius carbon price, and we're going to get from them their oil demand. And so what we did is we as I said, we surveyed the global EEE modelers. But in the results I'm going to show you right here, we're mostly using, and I saw somebody else use this in a slide earlier in this conference, EMF, that's the Energy Modeling Forum at Stanford, based at Stanford University, which brings together modeling teams and does different reports. Number 27 is the one that I'm referring to here, and there were 13 models involved in that. So that can give you a nice spread for under 2C, what might be that carbon price trajectory and what might be the oil demand trajectory. So we're using that as external to our model. And our median or mean, I can't remember, value was that the carbon price would hit $370 US in 2012 dollars, and that the demand would be down to about 65 million barrels per day. And I think from Paul's slide earlier, you had a lower price than 370 in the year 250. But that, and there's quite a range in those 13 studies. And I'm not going to report on that, but we do a lot of sensitivity analysis of putting in the different ranges of values and so on. But what does our model look like? So this is what takes the most part of my talk. First of all, we're not trying to predict short-run price disruptions. And what is a short-run price disruption? That's difficult to determine. But I have a slide that, in my extra slides, if that question is raised, sort of looking at, wow, the price of oil has been actually pretty low for much of the last 100 years. And we've got a couple of 12-year anomalies in there. So, and are they, and to what extent, related to short-run kinds of disruptions in the market? Secondly, and this is something that I could talk about for 5 minutes, but I can't, we assume no scarcity rents. So what we mean by that is there are energy economists have debated this for 30 years. Is there a part of the price of oil that isn't to do with a short-run disruption, but is actually to do with expectations of running out of oil, it being more valuable in the future, and therefore bidding up the price? And economists call that a scarcity rent or a hoteling rent. Well, if you looked at the literature, even people who've sort of become the leaders in the field in trying to find that scarcity rent have really had a lot of trouble finding it. And certainly, as we move forward into a world in which we can see how large oil resources could be relative to that declining oil demand, we decided not to put a scarcity rent element into our oil price determination model. That's a very quick justification, but if you want to go after me that in questions, I'd be happy to. The one element that we did put in there is a long-run OPEC market share strategy of 40 to 45% of production. Now remember, we're trying to run this model out sort of 3-4 decades. This isn't 100 years. And if you, well, I'll have a slide that will help explain this. So, and then finally, ours is a snapshot model, and this is also a bit complicated, but instead of us graphing all of the resources for oil out there and building a supply curve, you know, where you align them from cheapest to more expensive, we do this in a snapshot way. We just look at current production. So implicit in that, so 1 million barrels a day of OPEC, non-OPEC, and implicit in that is a notion that there's enough reserves behind each one of that production that we can focus on barrels per day. So here was my point about OPEC. People will say, well, OPEC, they've had a strong influence on the price of oil. The energy experts, economists that I talk to, say, well, it hasn't really been controlling it on a sort of a annual or five-year basis. It's been that Saudi Arabia and others have not invested as much as they could have, or that price would be a lot lower. At the same time, there's sort of a constraint there, and we've seen that kind of playing out over the last while, that OPEC has actually taken that what it just did recently is that it again said, we're not going to let the price get too low, But we also know we can't let the price get too high because we'll lose market share. So that's in the model, basically. And then, so here's what that curve looks like. This on top is just a blow up. So here's the curve. This is in million barrels per day. So here's the market in, I don't know, it was 213, 214. This is dollars per barrel. And then this is just a blow up of what's at the high cost margin of the snapshot supply curve, okay? And now here's the dynamics. So the model starts as a static portrayal of oil market shares, and it becomes dynamic as the carbon price rises and oil demand falls. So the carbon price changes the production cost of each type of resource. So we had a Norwegian speaker saying, you know, at least we're low emissions in production, so we should be able to stay competitive. So we're, how do oil sands do in that? And they'll, in our model, they'll either be investing in reducing emissions at the production level or paying carbon charges or some combination. This will force the marginal producers out and lower the oil price, because we calculate the oil price from who's at the margin, but it's a cloud at the margin, subject to that OPEC market share constraint. So, my second to last slide. This is complicated, but I'm just going to flip through it quickly because my PhD student said that I'd be able to explain this in 1 minute. So there's 2015, 2025, 2035, 2045. See where we're going. And that's that curve I already showed you. And this was the oil price that we figured out for 2015. I can't remember why. And so as you move from left to right, the carbon price is going up. 81, 166, 308. And that means the costs of oil sands and other producers are also moving up. At the same time, the oil demand, so I just presented it as a vertical line, it's at 90, now it's at 87, it's moving to the left. So that's the information, the carbon price and oil demand that we're taking from those models. And so the oil price is going down. There it is. Connected dots, last two bullets. It's possible to use global energy economy emission model outputs and an energy market pricing model to estimate the economic viability of fossil fuel project X under 2C, and this is our proposed method for doing that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. Let's move to our next presenter. Is Katya Pérez Guzmán from Facultad Latinoamericana de Ciencias Sociales in Mexico. Katya, you have 10 minutes.
Thank you very much. Okay, let's begin. I'm going to present two case studies of Colombia and Mexico, focusing basically on the political economy of the relationship between the oil supply policies and the climate change policies. Thank you very much. But first, I'm going to steal valuable time of my presentation to do a reflection a little bit of the conference, specifically of thinking about what type of problem we are facing. Clearly, the problem of oil supply and climate policy is not the same as the problem of demand, of consumption, and climate policy. What are the differences? What are we looking at? Is it a problem of control and compliance of oil industry? Is it a problem of social responsibility merely? Is it an economic? Is it solvable with the markets? Is it a common problem? Somebody said it. Is it a problem of a lack of international cooperation or political, institutional, historical, developmental? My presentation is going to focus more on this part. We think that at least for a category of countries, it is much more a problem of institutions and political systems than anything else. And that's important because how you frame the problem is how you get to the best solution possible. So the questions we try to ask in our case studies is who decides or who contests these decisions in Mexico and Colombia about the main actions regarding oil production and climate? What are the incentives and interests? And how do they interact or diverge in distinct political arenas? Basically, this is our definition of political economy. We know that political economy in the literature has many, many implications, but we focus mainly on actors that form alliances. That's our framing of the literature. The methodology implicit in what we wrote is institutionalism. We definitely take the stance that institutions matter. Institutions not just as being buildings, but as being people with interests and decisions, definitely bounded by where they're from and what interests they're serving. Not homogeneous. We're definitely not assuming that they are comparable in many ways. In this way, that's why we use the methodology of case studies, but very focused on complexity studies of Ragin 2000, which applied to case studies uses a lot of process tracing. And what that does is, what the name says, you get Mexico, Colombia, and perhaps other countries in the future, hopefully. For Mexico, you define different processes of interest to you, and then for Colombia, you do the same. For the other countries, you do the same. Of course, they're not going to be comparable. There will be many differences, and that's why sometimes you cannot even put them into models. But then what you do is you define exactly what you're going to base your analysis on. In this case, it's interactions between actors. There's two types of interactions, is intersections and discrepancies. That's all we were looking for. Do they intersect in the processes that we're looking, or do they not intersect? And of course, not all the processes. There's many things happening right now in Mexico and Colombia in terms of oil and climate change. But we focused on the main things that were happening from 2000 to 2015, which are oil rents is their process for Mexico and Colombia happening between oil actors and the rest of the society. As for Colombia, there were two oil reforms, very important for both countries. The law of energy transition in Mexico, which was the green part of the oil reform that we chose. Civil society in Mexico for renewables, and civil society in Colombia in general, because in Colombia the climate debate is still in the process of getting started, so we had to expand a little bit our search. And the definition of renewables, which you will say, why would the definition of renewables be even called a process in itself, no? In Mexico, it turns out it has been a years-long process of actually coming to terms of what we call renewables because of the reasons I will mention right away. So I would say just two results. The general results that who are the actors and how they interact. So in general, there is a very uneven playing field, as happens in other countries. This is not new. The institutionalism of oil is historic. It's very inside of Mexico's society and politics in very deep ways, versus the institutionalization of climate change, which is recent. In fact, here we have one person who promoted a lot of the institutionalization of climate change, but it is very recent. It has to go a long way. Policy networks describe a lot of what's going on in climate change in Mexico still. And basically, for oil, we saw that the main actors for Colombia and Mexico were the state and the oil company. And you will tell me, of course, I mean, it's Mexico, the company is nationally owned, so of course the state and the oil company will have to be the main actors. We emphasize this relationship because we found several literature that suggests that this is not only what happens in the places who have nationally owned companies, but for example, in the United States. The United States, there's a lot of deep relationships, maybe not so explicit, between the oil company and the state. So the state has to be considered. So the idea is the problem is not just about the oil company. The problem is about how the oil company relates to powerful political actors in the state. In Mexico and Colombia, what is a little bit more specific to them is that they are not petrostates, which I say here. There's a continuum between petrostate on one extreme, which is Venezuela, maybe. It's the state who relies a lot on production of oil. The exports of oil are a big part of the exports. Mexico and Colombia are not there. They're also, of course, not net importers, but they're somewhere in between. But what does characterize them is the economization of their fiscal accounts, which means that They rely 30% about each country on the fiscal spending relies on the money that they get from exports. But what's very particular about this, this Terry Lynn Carl says very clearly in her work on Venezuela, The Paradox of Plenty, is that statecraft is almost synonymous to fiscal spending. So doing state things in Mexico and Colombia means spending revenues, and these revenues come a lot from oil sales. So there's, this just shows another time the actors of oil in these countries show the very, very close relationship that there is with oil and other actors in the society. All this is very well planted in the natural resource cross literature. We just showed it a little bit, but I think this debate here in this conference would benefit a lot from this type of literature, aside from what has been shown already in the excellent presentations in the last days. For climate, the actors are highly heterogeneous, and more for Colombia than for Mexico. For Colombia, there are many things happening that are not even called climate. They are climate things, but they're not called that way. So we could not find specific patterns as with oil. No? And of course, the inequality that both countries have had for decades also translates into the inequality of civil society causes. In fact, there is a famous author that has called the environmentalist of the North of the South, which is, of course, no surprise in climate change. But that is not just in the literature. That is lived every day by a lot of us who are working as environmentalists in these countries. Because you cannot just go and say, oh, climate change is bad for you. There are so many things competing for the people's attention, like hunger and what you already know, that when you talk about climate change in some of these spaces, it's really not even relevant about talking about it. These are the results. I am not going to go in depth about them, of each processes what we saw about the main actors, the main things happening in the countries. But as you see, no surprise, a lot of the actors, like our moderator said in the beginning, they're diverging. Most actors, they are talking, of course, it's not that they're completely separate, but the activities and the actors diverge a lot. There's two very important interactions, the law of energy transition. There was a lot of talk about it. There was even a two-year delay between the reform and the law being actually passed. And the main topic of contention, as I said before, is the definition of renewables. And the reason why a lot of people came together in the gray color, which meant not necessarily our green agenda, was first because of the lack of coalitions in the green side. Definitely, we had responses, but it was not as strong as to pass it the way we wanted to. But also because some important actors in civil society a little bit took the side of contention, which was that the definition of renewables included carbon capture and sequestration, cogeneration, a lot of oil, low carbon oil technologies. So this was definitely a loss, and it was an example of actors coming together in the wrong direction. Just to close, Colombia's transmillennial and the civil society movement that formed around it and that continues to be formed around it got people together talking and aligning, but based on not on the topics of climate, but on the topics of co-benefits. So one of the main findings is co-benefits was one narrative that definitely ring the bells of people in Colombia and Mexico. In fact, Mexico's INDC, the main message about this document was co-benefits. Let's take co-benefits first and then the rest. And just to close, there were many things about banning oil industries, taking more oil. I like this cartoon because it's an oil-based economy. It's this big truck going downhill with all the signs, people telling them, no, don't go, let's stop. And banning these types of companies in these countries is kind of putting an emergency brake in this trailer. Like the colleague said yesterday was saying, Mexico is not going to stop doing this alone, no? It needs pressure, it needs a lot of things so that all this machinery that's going could stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Katya. Let's move on. The next presenter is going to be Henrik Wachtmeister from Uppsala University. Henrik, you have the floor. 10 minutes, please.
Yeah, thank you. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm Henrik Wachtmeister. I'm a PhD student at Uppsala University, Sweden. And today I will present some work in progress that looks on the difference in investment and production dynamics of conventional oil and unconventional. Conventional oil and unconventional oil. And when I say unconventional oil, I mean tight oil only today. So shale oil, the US Bakken and Eagle Ford kind of type of oil. And then I will explore whether this difference in investment production dynamics has any implications for climate and energy strategy. So let's start with a little look on recent developments. In this graph we have global oil production and price, and we can see the recent quite dramatic price drop, which sometimes is blamed, or quite often blamed, on the tight oil. And if we look at the second graph, we can understand a little bit more why. Here we have total production broken up in conventional, the black line, and unconventional, the blue one in the bottom. We also have investments in these kind of categories in this graph. And here we can see around 2005, conventional oil reached some kind of stagnation, and we had the price increase. And also, at around the same time, we had the technological breakthrough making the US tight oil available. So following this, we have the surge in investment, and quite rapidly surge in production in this category source, ultimately leading then to an oversupply and price collapse on the global oil market. So apparently there seems to be more oil available than we thought just a few years back. And this maybe is not in line with the unburnable carbon and carbon locking concerns that we've been hearing about these 2 days. And also some recent research point out that oil is particularly prone to these carbon lock-in effects since it's highly capital and rent intensive. But as Professor Rikens pointed out yesterday, all oil is not the same. So now tight oil having this very fast dynamics, could it be that it's actually better in some of these carbon lock-in concerns? So that's simply the aim of this study, to document the difference and explore if it has any implications for carbon locking concerns. And we do this in 4 steps. So we start with an individual study of fields and wells, empirical study, and then we derive some standard production profiles for conventional and tight oil. And then we use these profiles in a bottom-up approach to explore the aggregate dynamics of production and investments. And then finally, we just discuss potential implication of this difference in production dynamics. So first, let's have a look at the conventional oil fields. They look something like this. We have a discovery, then we have investments starting and decreasing, and then following, we have production building up, reaching a plateau, and then decline. And as you can see, these kind of giant oil fields have very long lifetimes. It could be several decades. And also we have the capital structure. So you have the initial investment before most of the production. And then we know we have quite low operating costs. So with this kind of cost structure, the incentive is to keep on producing even though oil prices go down quite low. It has to go below the operating costs. If you look at unconventional, on the other hand, these kind of individual wells declines very, very fast. So here we look at monthly production data. So this is only 3 years of production. And as you can see, in practice, it starts declining immediately after around 3 years. Only about 10% of the initial production rate is still there. And we know that drilling and fracking a new well could take only a matter of months, so it's very fast if you want to hit a new well. And then from looking at several thousand of tight oil wells and hundreds of fields, we come up with these kind of standard production profiles that we can compare. And first of all, you can see the different scales. So a conventional giant oil field equals several thousands of tight oil wells. But also there's a similar initial capital cost structure and low operating costs. So both these kind of sources has incentive to keep on producing while investments are spent. And but here we have the same kind of, here we have production on annual basis. Now the difference becomes very clear how fast, first of all, the investment production dynamic is, and also the very, very high decline rate compared to conventional fields. So even though these kind of production types can have similar per barrel capital cost, which is sometimes used as a metric of carbon locking strength, since the title has such high decline and short lifetime, that should entail that title has actually lower carbon locking effects or strength. So these kind of individual fields and wells translates to some different aggregate dynamics. So this bottom-up approach is just simply adding fields and wells on top of each other, and then we can see the aggregate behavior. So the first one is conventional oil. For 25 years of constant capital deployment, we got something that looks like a bell shape. So when investment stops, we have a kind of moderate decline, and also you can see there's a lot of legacy production. There's still going to be production even though new investment stops. Unconventional, on the other hand, it looks more like a shark fin or something like that. And you can see there's a very fast increase, and then when new investment stops, production declines very fast, and not as much legacy production locked in. And in the paper, we use this kind of approach to investigate some real-world examples. For example, constant investment, constant production, also investments constrained by a 2-degree scenario. Sorry. And this kind of exercise, two main results. And it's simply that title can deliver required production flow in the near term at the lower amount of annual investment rate. And this is just a direct result of the more front-loaded production profile. And for a 2-degree scenario, investments need to start increasing quite soon. So what kind of conclusions can we draw from this kind of exercise? First of all, I think it's very important to consider these kind of lifetimes when assessing carbon lock-in strength. And since tight oil has less capital and production locked in, it should entail a weaker carbon lock-in effect, which in turn should mean less resistance to transitions and less risk for stranded assets. So this kind of flexibility should be good for both sides, so both for oil developers and also climate policymaking, for example. Maybe there can be some common ground here. And also this fast investment production dynamics could lead to shorter periods of oversupply and undersupply, which would entail less volatility. And I think Christoph told us this earlier, that volatile prices is probably the worst kind of scenario for a transition. So that in itself is good. And if marginal costs of production is coming down, this kind of production source could give a period of moderate prices, which in turn would reduce rents for low-cost producers, which could weaken their carbon, like more institutional carbon lock-in. So here's just some points that came up while doing this research, which I sent out to the audience and the panel for further discussion and investigation. And first of all, the location of title being in the US, what does that mean compared to production in other countries, OPEC countries or developing countries? And also the organization of the oil sector, the tight oil sector. It's mostly small and medium-sized companies doing this. It's not majors or not national oil companies, so power is not as concentrated. And this in part because of this kind of technology, which involves not that much capital for a new well, for example. So it's low barriers to entry, kind of lesser returns to scale, which according to some literature is like the main driver of institutional lock-in. So this question I posed to the audience, myself, my fellow panelists. My title actually provide a helpful first step in an oil transition, or is it only bad news? I'm not sure, but let's discuss it. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. We still have 15 seconds to go, but thank you very much. Let's move to the next presenter. It's Tzeporah Berman from York University and Alberta government. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have 10 minutes.
And just this? Thank you so much. And first of all, I would like to be clear that the opinions that I'm expressing are my own here today and not those of the Alberta government. The Alberta Climate Plan, which was introduced late in 2015, includes in it a complete phase out of coal, a tripling of renewable energy production, an economy-wide carbon tax, a limit on emissions from the oil sands. It also contains very strong energy efficiency plans and a commitment to reduce methane from the oil and gas sector by 45%, a commitment that very likely gave Canada the capacity to commit nationally to methane reduction by 45% and to work with the U.S. to harmonize this across North America. It has been lauded by some as a historic climate policy, as a breakthrough, and certainly in Canada, it has also been attacked by come under heavy attack, both as being too strong by some and too weak by others. Many were very surprised to see five of the largest oil company CEOs on the stage with Premier Rachel Notley when she announced the plan, as well as five environmental leaders from environmental organizations. The remarkable support from unlikely allies came in large part because of the strength of civil society campaigns against fossil fuel development and infrastructure across North America in the last 6 to 8 years. It also, of course, came as a result of a multi-year effort to create a collaboration within the oil industry and the environmental community. For 2 years now, a number of us from the environmental sector have been meeting with oil CEOs and trying to reach common ground on climate policy. However, underpinning the diffuse sectoral support is a very different vision of the future. The oil industry hopes to maintain and in fact increase production by reducing emissions and decarbonizing oil. While the environmental organizations believe that the Climate Leadership Plan is the first step towards planning for a managed decline of oil. Over the past couple of years, both parties have been able to agree on the value of a carbon price to stimulate innovation and reduce emissions. And both were willing to support an emissions limit to provide some planning certainty. Both parties have agreed on the need for Alberta and Canada to do our fair share in reducing emissions and to meet Canada's climate targets to create a pathway to 2050. And so in a lot of ways, the Alberta Climate Plan is historic in that what we've seen in Canada has been this incredible polarization of the debate that has paralyzed policy progress for many, many years. And I won't go into the politics at length here, but suffice it to say that Canada's economy and culture has been, since colonization, a resource-based economy. This is simply an added historical layer to the dominant view perpetuated by conservatives in the fossil fuel industry in Canada, and I think in many supply-side regions, that continued growth of fossil fuel development is essential to the economic health of our country. Over the last decade, Canadians have been subject to a barrage of advertising that I can only believe is, and I call, peacetime propaganda, that claimed that continued oil sands development was essential to keeping our hospitals open and our roads paved. Criticizing tar sands development, especially in Alberta, was widely criticized as anti-Canadian. In fact, this open letter to Canadians appeared in the Globe and Mail national newspaper from the last administration during the debate over the Gateway pipeline. Anyone that criticized or expressed concerns about the pipeline was considered a radical extremist that was trying to kill good projects, that was trying to hijack the regulatory system. Our own Prime Minister at the time, Prime Minister Harper, pulled Canada out of Kyoto, declaring at the time that it was, and I quote, a socialist scheme to suck money out of good people. However, I want to use my brief time remaining to talk about this policy conundrum, because since the election of a new majority Liberal federal government and a new majority progressive government in Alberta, the first change in government from a far-right government, by the way, in 44 years, new political space and narratives have opened up in Canada. We now have governments that believe in climate change as a priority, that have committed to the Paris Agreement, that support the importance of the 1.5 degree goal. But here's the rub. They also believe that Canada should green its oil industry, and that while we will use far less fossil fuels in the future, whatever piece of the pie oil makes up in 2030, in 2040, in 2050, we have a right to compete for that piece of the pie. Essentially, the argument is being made that as carbon price increases, it will increase innovation, make expensive technologies accessible, and we will reduce the carbon content per barrel below conventional, from the dirtiest oil to the cleanest oil. The world will use less oil in the future, but it will still need some oil, and it might as well be ours. We have a right to compete. Many companies I talk to when faced with the carbon math will also talk about the potential for CCS in the trunk, literally, in the trunk of cars. That eventually we will be able to simply contain carbon emissions from combustion vehicles. This, what I call post-denial narrative, created by the oil and gas sector, accepts climate science, supports carbon pricing and decarbonization pathways, while arguing that future expansion is necessary to pay for the low carbon transition, and arguing for the right to produce more oil regionally to capture a piece of the global demand in a climate-constrained world. It is, I believe, one of the greatest barriers to a managed decline pathway. The second critical barrier is that supply-side regions like Canada have no incentive to constrain carbon beyond reducing production emissions. Just meeting our INDC is a major challenge for Canada, given the decades of inaction and the growing emissions from the oil and gas industry. Yet I think we know here from the carbon math that it's not enough. So how do we keep two-thirds in the ground from a policy perspective? It's not going to come from a price of carbon to ensure a safe climate. Not in North America. We've worked long and hard to get carbon pricing accepted in Canada. We've had major breakthroughs this year. We now have a carbon price on 80% of the population in Canada, and soon a national price. But that price will be at most $30. What would a price be that would constrain carbon? Many of you know, in Canada, for CCS to be viable, we're looking at $100 to $280. So how do we chart a policy pathway to transition off oil when national and regional governments and export economies are only responsible for production emissions? I will end by giving you a little window into our foray into a legislated emissions limit in the oil sands as an additional policy mechanism. So a year ago, this was considered heresy. In fact, the first time I raised the idea of an emissions limit with the oil industry, chaos ensued in the meeting. The government, even our new majority progressive government, would not have considered it if we didn't have oil industry leaders supporting it. Our thinking was that we needed Alberta to acknowledge that today's reality required limits. Knowing that the carbon price was not going to be enough to constrain production significantly, we needed another tool. Alberta currently emits about 70 million tons, which arguably should have been the limit if we look simply at the science. The problem was threefold. The government wouldn't agree to a limit without the oil industry leader's support. Without support, it would have been political suicide. Industry wouldn't agree to a limit that didn't allow for some growth, so that each company could reassure their shareholders that there were growth opportunities. Tens of thousands of people have lost their jobs in Alberta in the last year as a result of the oil price decline. Calgary is a ghost town. Suicide rates and women's shelter rates have skyrocketed. And a good portion of the difference between 70 million tons and 100 million tons, which is where we set the limit, was already under construction, steel in the ground. So what does 70 million tons actually mean, 100 million tons actually mean, though? I argue that, in fact, it is the first keep it in the ground legislation, because we have about 2.3 million barrels a day now in the oil sands. 100 million tons with current technology is about 3.8 million barrels per day. We have already approved permits given out, 5.4 million barrels per day. We have 7.2 million barrels per day under approval. So this limit with current technology essentially mothballs a third of the existing permits. Okay, so let me wrap up then. So from a culture and from a policy perspective, the limit is extremely significant, but it has forced divisions within the oil industry, many calling the five CEOs traitors. But it has created a public conversation in an oil jurisdiction about limits in the climate era, but it's not enough. Many argue that it's put Canada on the map to meeting our INDC. Alberta has gone from this emissions trajectory to this with the new climate policy. But at the same time, we know that Canada is projected to produce more oil production than many other jurisdictions in the next 20 years. And we also know that this is what it would look like if we produced no new tar sands. This, because when you invest in the oil sands, it lasts quite a long time. Once that infrastructure is in, it produces for a significant time. So the fact is, we haven't done enough to ensure that we meet the challenge set out in the Nature paper, the challenge that we've talked about here on carbon budget. And of course, the conversation on global equity is not penetrating at all. So how do we ensure that the conversation on carbon budget and global equity penetrates into the national and subnational policy development? The bottom line is that there's a huge disconnect between what we know needs to be done and what even this stable economy, this wealthy economy with a progressive majority government, is doing. As long as doing our fair share is defined by decision makers as meeting our INDC and constraining carbon is not counted in any way in a supply-side region, then we will only work on reducing our production emissions. So what is the policy pathway? Until we can chart that course, we'll continue to have these, what some say is only incremental policy gains and growing civil society opposition to new infrastructure like pipelines, which, while quite successful, I have to say, in constraining new development, is draining resources from frontline communities and further polarizing our communities at a moment in our history when we need to be coming together to develop resiliency plans for community safety in the face of a changing climate.
Well, thank you very much. I'd like to thank the presenters for being so obedient and following the 10 minutes or 12 in some cases. I'm going to open for discussion now, but I want to use the position I have here just to raise one question to Mark. Mark, is your model capable of capturing the impact of oil prices on the cost of producing oil?
Of oil prices on the cost of producing oil?
Oil, yeah, because normally when prices go up, the cost of producing oil also go up.
So, because of internal consumption of oil?
No, simply because normally say you have more demand for equipment, more for everything.
Oh, okay.
And this has a huge impact on oil costs.
Yeah, definitely not. So, for example, if I can reflect what you're saying, in Alberta, when we rapidly expanded oil sands at an earlier time, the cost of production went up because of inflation. But we see that this is a long-run model, so I wasn't going to touch that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's open for questions. We have one here, two, okay, three. So far, let's see, three and four, and let's stop for the next run.
Okay. I'm Greg Muttett, Oil Change International. I'd like to ask one to Mark and one to Henrik, if I may. To Mark, the thing that jumped out at me was your 65 million barrels a day in 2050 of demand, which sounds very high. Presumably, you're using a 50% chance of staying within 2 degrees. Certainly, it can't be any more than that, according to the numbers I've seen. But the question is, the bigger question this raises is, given what we're told about the severe dangers that occur beyond 2 degrees C, what is a reasonable level of confidence that we will stay under it? Is it 50? Is it 66%? Is it 80% or even 90%? The question for Henrik is, I'd certainly agree that shale wells don't have a lock-in effect that many other types of production have. The exception to that, though, of course, is pipelines, which have the same lock-in effect. And to be topical, an example is the Dakota Access Pipeline. The question I wanted to ask you, though, is how does this interact with other ways of looking at climate limits? Lock-in is, of course, an important one, but the limited carbon budget is another. And isn't Katya raised the issue that climate change is as much a political problem as an economic one? Don't we have a problem in climate politics that everyone looks for a reason why they can keep producing and why someone else should cut? And so isn't there a difficulty there in saying maybe this kind of production is okay for expansion?
Hi, Doug Coppola from EarthTrack. My initial question is for Tzeporah. It sounds like Alberta is doing some very positive changes, and I was interested in hearing whether there's a risk of backsliding. There was a new administration that made these possible. If someone else comes in, are some of them going to dissipate? And then the second sort of flip side of that, which is more general to the panel, we've heard a lot over the last few days about how none of these changes are going to do enough. And I guess the general question is there positive feedback loops in technological development that you see that if we take small steps, we'll actually start to see some acceleration in the developments on the ground in the right direction?
Yes, please. And then Peter, let's go. Okay. Can go Peter first and then we can go. Okay. Good exercise.
Hi, with Cicero. Just a very quick question also for Tzeporah. I wonder if you can expand on this 100 million ton limit and how specifically how it's being enforced on will it have consequences for approval of specific projects or how is that going to work? Thanks.
And then Peter, and then it's Fatma. Peter, please.
Hi, Pete Erickson with SEI. Mark, this is really exciting what you're doing because there's so little information out there about what oil price might be under a 2 degree pathway. And I think could you just expand a little bit upon how you would apply that as a climate test? I think it was you were getting there at the end, or maybe I just missed it. But I think what happens is you know essentially if the project would be a go at that price, then it is quote consistent with the 2 degree pathway. If not, then not. But if you could expand upon that, that'd be great. Thanks.
Okay, so let's move to the panelists. Mark, can you
start? Sure. I'll go backwards. So in the particular case where I was developing this for was that there are regulatory processes to approve pipelines. And in fact, the pipeline that's gonna come down to Vancouver, in the 90s, I was the chair of the Utilities Commission and I regulated that pipeline. So it was all very familiar to me, but, and especially the way our regulatory process works. For these major projects, the federal government would have to have the final approval, but they're following the logic that regulators have always done for utilities, which is that you have to be able to demonstrate that it's economically viable. So we call it used and useful, some term from North America. And so that would be the argument, it's non-economic. And I admit I raced so fast through that
graph that my PhD student promised me I could do in 1 minute that I think I finished without saying, and now you can see the oil sands are higher in cost than the oil price. So that would be the evidence brought before that process. The question about 65 million barrels a day, so that's all external, exogenous to what we do. So we were just taking Energy Modeling Forum 27. Now, I can't remember if it was 50% probability of 450 parts per million or what, but then we surveyed a whole bunch of other modeling exercises as well, and it's all over the... I do a nice probability distribution around that. I can have it in some scenarios, say we do an incredible amount of electricity where it shows 90 million barrels a day in 2050 or almost still up there. And one of the models in EMF 27 had that outcome. And these were models that had carbon capture and storage, but then there were two that had BECCS, right? Biological carbon capture and storage, I forget the right name. And of course, those ones could be even higher with oil demand, but I excluded them from our data set just so we had a consistent. So it can be all over the place, down to 40, up to 90. And someone asked about tipping points. I shouldn't even try to comment on that. I would hope that there is. I would hope that if, that's why I'm a strong advocate of zero and low emission vehicle, you know, requiring that to happen quickly in the way that California is, and we're trying to do that in Canada now, because maybe there'll be a tipping point in electric and even biofuel vehicles, I don't know. And likewise, somebody talked about CCS earlier, miles, you know, that too can have a tipping point.
Yes, so regarding other infrastructure supporting tidal, that's true, I agree. And that's maybe one of the major reasons why the tidal increased so fast in the US, a lot of large existing pipeline networks, for example, supporting the production. And who's oil to produce, very difficult to say. I guess I'm only stressing that this flexibility could be favorable for like the end game of oil production, for example, for exit strategy for companies. That the flexibility in itself is a positive thing. So, considering some discrete supply side policy solely aimed at tidal, probably, or it could be counterproductive to overall transition strategy. So I think that's the point I'm just trying to make. But who's oil to produce? Bit of a question, economic question, mostly decided by these costs right now. Yeah.
So I'll address the backsliding question first. I kind of can't underscore enough what a big shift this is from, especially inside Alberta. Part of the reason that I had notes today is because we are live streamed. And every comment I or anyone from the Alberta government makes at this point relative to climate change or the future of the oil industry is scrutinized by the opposition. There have been three press releases in the last 30 days calling for me to be fired in Alberta from the opposition. And so it's a very, it's a tinderbox. A year ago, we had a government that ridiculed climate change policy, a year and a half ago. And so there is a massive backlash inside the province now against especially the coal plants being shut down and also the carbon tax. There's signs up all along the highways, this tax will kill families and things like that. And so I raise that because I think that there are two ways to deal with backsliding. One is through hard legislation. So this government is committed to passing legislation on each of these initiatives and has already passed legislation in the House on the carbon tax and on the renewable portfolio standard. And there is legislation currently being drafted on the emissions limit. It will be a hard cap, it will be legislated. But the second is the cultural shift. The polling shows that Albertans do care about climate change and they're tired of feeling guilty and feeling like the bad guy. And so we're working to create a narrative and a conversation in Alberta that makes people proud of these steps and makes it very difficult for any future government, if there's a change in administration, to move backwards. On the 100 million tons and how it's going to be enforced, it will be a hard cap,
But how that works under the cap is still being discussed. So I'm the co-chair of the Oil Sands Advisory Committee. One of my other co-chairs is Dave Collier, the former CEO of Shell and CAP, Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers. And this panel is looking at how it's going to work. And there's a lot of opinions, everything from the markets will take care of it. You know, we can just dial up the carbon tax or the performance benchmarks under the carbon tax if it doesn't work, if we're near the limit, to many academics proposing that we have a mini cap and trade system for the oil sands companies inside Alberta under the 100 million tons. And we are tasked with making recommendations to the government on that topic by November.
Gotcha.
On the question of positive feedback loops of extraction, I don't know. I don't know if extraction itself has these positive things that can lead like magically to the path we want. But I definitely think it's about framing the issue right. No? It's not easy, of course. I was thinking it's very similar to the climate negotiations, the gridlock that they got some years was precisely because the issue was framed as Annex A, Annex B, China, somewhere, you know. It's hard to get out of there. So I think part of this conference, the objective is we have to think about how to put the problem. I think Greg was saying that OPEC can be a catalyzer. I completely agree. The oil countries can be active in this way. But then you have to think about how to put it so that they actually participate, so that they're not, it's not something banned, no, or prohibited. I don't know. Let's think.
Thank you, Katya. We still have time to go to a second round of questions. Okay, here and then here. There, okay.
Yes, this is a question for Tzeporah. These are very good news about Alberta and the shift in policy, and it's very admirable to have all those actors together in agreement. And it's very positive in terms of Alberta and Canadian emissions. Now, in terms of, as we were talking over lunch, in terms of extracting tar sands, they will still continue to be extracted because 90% of them are exported. So what I was wondering is whether the local issues are addressed, because the extraction of tar sands has high impacts, I believe, or I think, on communities and the environment. So how do these actors feel about that? And are they in agreement? Or are these costs being addressed?
Next one here. Yes, please.
I'm Christoph from the IEA. One quick question for Henrik and one for Mark. Henrik, the evidence of the tight oil production over the past 18 months shows us that although individual wells might decline very quickly, the industry as a whole across the US hasn't particularly. It's gone down slightly and the rise stopped. But if we were to take Mark's long-term oil price of $40, which is where we were at for a while there, that would suggest that the tight oil industry would keep going. And so I was wondering if you could comment to some extent on the fact that the empirical evidence suggests that tight oil might not be quite so responsive to climate policy as you suggest. And for Mark, I was just wondering, a technical question on the modelling. How do you take account of the capacity which is available in each year? So if you make an investment in 2025, you then don't have that investment, that capacity available to come online in 2035. And then also, how does that is that reflected in the costs? And then do the costs over time reflect technology changes and depletion changes?
Yes, we have someone behind there. Yeah, we have two people there, and then Shiva, and then this lady here, and then we have this dog.
Sorry, I had a question.
So I have two questions. One is, all tight oil the same, or is there any differentiation between that in how you calculated that? I think it's a similar question to what was just asked. And then for Katya, thank you for your presentation. I think it was extremely important addition to what we've seen today, maybe linked to the questions that we had at the opening of the session, is the political economy here often ends up just as like a bullet when it's maybe the most important part of the discussion. And so I just have a question, if you could speak a little more to what more research possibilities there is there in this space, and how could we link that to more explicitly to some of the economics modeling and discussion so that we don't have them happening in separate streams. I don't even know what I'm asking, except that it seems like this could be important, and I'm curious from an expert.
Okay, please, the lady here. Yes.
For Henrik, another question about tight oil, how the increase in methane emissions factors into the analysis that you've done. And then for Tzeporah, from your experience engaging with the companies around the limit in Alberta, what, if any, lessons can we draw in terms of in terms of global companies aligning their own business models and looking at ways that they can limit their emissions and commit to hard caps on their own emissions?
Tzeporah, thank you. When you refer to suicides and mothers and children living in shelters, you really bring home the dislocation and the hardship that's associated with keeping it in the ground. And so I'm wondering if you could, one, mention any measures that the Alberta government has taken to try to help absorb that hardship, and two, if you can speculate about what would a solution to keeping it in the ground that's equitable to the, say, tens of millions of people in communities who are reliant on extraction, what would a approach look like that could be equitable?
Then the final question here in front, and then we have to stop and move to the presenters.
Thank you very much. I was wondering how in countries like Katya said, the climate change is not a priority feeling or problematic question to solve, as you said, in Sephora, in Alberta, in Canada. People are tired feeling guilty about climate change and the pollution and so on. How to go there? Because in Colombia or in Mexico, we are not. No, people are concerned with more other questions. I wonder if it is because not Colombia or Mexico are petro states, not even oil economies, because the weight in the GDP and employment so is lower than that. Okay. But perhaps it is, I don't know, that oil in our regions is located in not densely populated areas, very backward areas in Mexico and Colombia, Indian population. And they have different problems. British Petroleum found in Colombia the biggest oil fields after Alberta, about 7 billion barrels. But people there ask BP, British Petroleum, to build hospitals, to build roads, to build schools and so on, and that is their social responsibility. It doesn't matter that if they ask for those expenditures to be discounted from the taxes. But those are the problems. People are not concerned there. Well, it is in the forest or it is in the planicies. The sky is green, the sky is blue. There is no concern about that. People in the urban areas feel that oil is a question of British Petroleum or the state company. And that is a question of the regions and so on. We are not concerned. How to increase awareness about our common problem, that is climate change? How to feel guilty?
Thank you. Now we have to move to the panelists. Who wants to start? Mark?
Maybe I'll start. I only had one question. Christoph, you were asking, how does the model account for let's say I had a category there called OPEC, and there's depletion going on. So isn't the cost of OPEC also going to move up over that time because of investments to renew on that depletion? So I think this might come from a conversation I had with you about a year ago at UCL, but I made sure that that was well-researched, and I know we don't have the detail that you have in your model, but basically we found that any change in, because we're talking about the oil demand heading down towards 65 million barrels, and in those categories we compared the total reserve to the depletion over that time frame, and because we're lumping them together as well, so some people could draw down and somebody turns on the taps a bit more, we found that the price effect, you know, would be, of our scenario that I showed you, would be less than $4 or $5 at most. So in other words, the depletion effect gets swamped by the carbon price effect, and so we left it out of the model.
On the question on research, there's definitely a connection between the natural resource curse and climate change. The natural resource curse literature is wide. It has a lot of implications, some of them contradictory, but climate change is not very present in a lot of it. In fact, we only found the famous carbon curse literature, which is the one relation between them. Here in Oxford, it's being done, but as far as we know, there's just one article and not much has been said about it. That's a very interesting proposal. And definitely the Stockholm Environmental Institute already has identified in their page many research things that can happen. For example, the external forces, the external institutions, the way that they can orient developing countries like Mexico. Mexico would definitely respond to a lot of the things that the US does, for example, in this direction. So external institutions and forces is definitely another topic.
Yeah, so first, Christoph. So the aggregate production, the real production in US tight oil is flat or decreasing slightly, so not very fast. And I guess it's a combination of factors. First, we have backlogs, so a lot of wells that had been drilled that you could just frack and take into production. And also, as I only showed, first of all, this work is only conceptual, so it's just to show the dynamics. In reality, there's quite different, there's a distribution of productivity in different wells, so I only show the average well, for example. So you can shift, if you know in this region, in this kind of area, this particular good well, so you can shift your efforts to the most productive parts. And also a little bit of financing. Maybe some companies even going with a deficit, or they have hedge prices, things like that. So more or less, the industry is telling they are getting more efficient on every point, but I think they do as well. But also at some point, it depends on the marginal production cost. You said $40. I don't know exactly where it's gonna be, but somewhere between 40 and 70, I think tight oil is gonna start producing at the margin again. What else? So we only looked at Texas Eagle Ford wells for this study. There's not, for average wells, there's not huge difference between different plays, so they look similarly the same, but there can be quite big difference between individual wells. So as a company, you have like a portfolio of wells, so the average is profitable, but some wells may be a really bad deal, otherwise some are really good, for example. And then we have methane emissions, so that's very important. I haven't looked into that in my own study, but so that can undermine the argument saying tight oil is good. So there's a lot of studies looking at that. So the first were kind of concerned about leakage, that it was quite high, so it could be really bad, even compared to oil sands, for example. But these recent studies done by Stanford and Carnegie Endowment, they do some kind of oil climate index. They try to look at the production emissions from different kinds of oils. And then shale oil is quite low, actually, compared to many conventional fields, actually. But it depends on leakage and how much flaring you have, actually. That was my questions, I think. Yeah.
Thank you. So first, Maria, on the local issues, Well, so first of all, I will say that the environmental community has been working now for many years to forge alliances with the indigenous community and many different nations in Alberta. And so part of what we did was insist when we started talking about the climate plan that, we couldn't separate out those issues. So on the Oil Sands Advisory Committee, our mandate, our terms of reference, includes a review of regulatory issues relative to cumulative impacts and scientific thresholds on toxics, water, air, and biodiversity. And so that will be the task that the committee takes on after the emissions limit recommendations. And we also supported the Indigenous community's call for funds for low carbon economic development for their nations that come from the carbon tax revenue. The carbon tax by 2018 will be bringing in $3 billion a year into the Alberta government. And so some of that money will go to Indigenous communities for low carbon economic development, as well as an Indigenous climate learning center in Alberta. So that's some of the ways that those issues are being going to be looked at. On the just transition, the Alberta government has responded by increasing the minimum wage, highest in Canada now, $15 an hour, extended unemployment benefits, and is on the cusp of developing a process with the federal government for a just transition strategy. And looking at retraining programs as well. You know, how we address this globally in an equitable manner, I think, is the subject of this conference. And I think we'll address it in the closing panel to some extent. I really believe that we need to figure out rules for supply side accounting, that this is the massive disconnect we have in the global conversation, that there has to be some kind of category for avoided emissions. I mean, I'm not saying that, developed countries, a country like Canada, should receive funds in the way that, you know, Maria's proposal looks at, you know, funds for high biodiversity areas in developing nations. But there has to be some incentive for constraining carbon, or the system doesn't work. It relies on, you know, carbon tax and regulatory environment, and we have a time gap. It's not going to be enough. And so how we do that in an equitable way, I feel like we're just in the beginning of that conversation, so I don't have those answers. On the how do you make people feel guilty, well, I'm an expert at that, having spent 10 years designing environmental campaigns. But I think that is the rub, right? The Alberta was the subject of an international and national campaign, and, you know, from Keystone to and for 10 years. And so people knew that there was a problem that had to be fixed. However, the response was just a defensive response until we started changing the conversation, until this government started changing the conversation. And what's changed now is a shared sense of purpose, that this is the writing on the wall. And of course, I mean, it helps that everyone from, you know, the Pope to the World Bank is talking about climate change now. And so, you know, it's a sense of the world is changing. And the narrative that we've been trying to use more and more in Alberta is one of, you know, forgiveness. We didn't know what we know today when we started developing the oil sands, when you, you know, trained as an oil sands engineer. Now we know. What are we going to do together? And that shared sense of purpose is, I think, the nub of how we'll move forward. And then finally, on the companies, the woman from the Unicorn Scientist, sorry, I've forgotten your name. Two things. Relationships matter. And specifics matter. So all too often we go into these company conversations and we have representatives from organizations, a different one every time, and we wonder why it doesn't work. And so creating a conversation with individuals across huge ideological barriers and lived experience required, you know, 2 years. And the specifics mattered. You know, all companies now, most oil companies will say they support carbon pricing, but what carbon pricing? And we framed our work in their language, right? We talked about certainty and stimulating innovation. Those were things that they could understand, and we created a common conversation on that. And I think what's also really important is we have to stop treating industry like a monolith, because they're not. And the reason five companies supported the emissions limit is they all see their projects going forward underneath of it. So they're going to all compete with each other, but that's okay. Because in a, certainly in a jurisdiction like Alberta, and I would argue in almost every jurisdiction in around the world, it changes the political calculus if you have those CEOs standing on stage supporting that specific policy. And, you know, we don't see the pathway to 2050 in the same way, but we'll argue that when we come to it.
Thank you very much. Well, we have time for two more questions. If they... Okay, one there, and one here, and that's it. Please.
Yeah, Paul Eakins, UCL. This is for Tzeporah, and thank you for a really inspiring presentation. I wondered how important in your getting consensus around the idea of a carbon tax in Alberta. And I have to say, if you'd asked me 10 years ago if Alberta would be having a carbon tax, I'd have thought you'd taken leave of your senses, which is why hope is always there, because these kinds of changes can happen and we need to be ready for them. How important was the British Columbia experience with carbon tax? Because I was in Vancouver talking to the guys who had designed that some years ago, and it seemed to be very successful, albeit coming from a quite different part of the political spectrum. And that was kind of really interesting to me. And I just wonder if you can talk a bit about that, because carbon pricing is something that's come up once or twice. It's problematic, it's difficult. And yet, here we have an example in a part of the world where I would have said it is least likely to emerge. And you're the neighbor of British Columbia, which has been a beacon in North America for carbon taxation for the last 5 years or even longer, perhaps.
Thank you. And then the final question behind there.
Thank you. Gagnil Dala, University of Cambridge. I have a question also to on Canada and Alberta, because I see some similarities with what we had in our panel discussion on challenges for the Norwegian oil industry just before, earlier today, on this, how although the industry also acknowledges the limits and climate change, there is a, both within Norwegian petroleum companies and Norwegian government per se, a kind of discrepant, like there is no connection really between our ambitions to, or the government's ambitions to develop further petroleum fields in the Barents Sea and the commitments that have been made in Paris and that also have been made before. So I'm just kind of wondering if you can expand a bit on the specifics of how you got this conversation together across all of these differences and how that can be potentially transferred to other countries like, say, Norway or the UK or other countries that have that kind of carbon development.
Okay, so let's move to the panelists.
Well, I'll try that one first. The first step, I think, is really trying to find those leaders within industry who can hear you, you know, who are already there. There's people within every company, you know, who really actually want to have this conversation. They're good people. They want to do the right thing. They're inside those companies, and they understand and are studying carbon pricing and good climate policy, and so. Part of it is finding the right people to have the conversation with who can be champions inside the company, and then sticking with it. So it took 2 years to get agreement on what kind of carbon pricing each of the communities could support. And what, I mean, you're already there on carbon pricing, but like on the emissions limit, et cetera. And not trying to jump over the hard parts of the conversation that may seem not as critical. We often go into these meetings and we're immediately talking about this policy or that policy. We probably spent 6 months talking about how do we define fair share? What do we really think about climate change? You know, we had conversations like how do we see technological change? You know, I can remember a specific conversation when one of the CEOs blew up at me and said,
Well, all right, but you're saying that you have tremendous faith in the destabilizing technologies that you like, you know, electric cars and battery storage, and you have zero faith in our potential for technological change, and we're the ideological ones, you know, and so those types of conversations led to the creation of principles. So, okay, so we want to create policy that stimulate innovation, that give everybody a chance to compete, but they have to have limits. They have to ensure Canada does our fair share. And we laid out principles. And from those principles, then we started talking about how to meet emissions reduction goals or what does carbon pricing look like. And so it's not fast. And it really involves, you know, creating conversations that are not necessarily linear, because people are just people, right? And I mean, I definitely had CEOs say to me after one meeting, you know, as a CEO, on any other issue, I don't surround myself with people who agree with me. And I didn't realize I was doing that on climate change until these conversations. And that, you know, and because you don't get to be a CEO of a major oil company unless you're quite brilliant. And so appealing to those people as smart people and trying to have that conversation really changed, I think, the conversation in Alberta. We had a rule that it had to be the same people, and that it had to be, like, once people started seeing value in the conversation, it had to be every couple of months, it had to be the same people, and we had to block out 3 hours each time because we knew the conversations were going to go long. And for 2 years, they were not public conversations. We literally met I remember the one restaurant we had to walk through the kitchen to get to because we had to come in a back door so no one in Calgary could see us meeting together, because, you know, the debates within the media are going to be positional. They're not going to be conversations, right? And so we kept it out of the public. So then on the BC carbon tax, yes, it provides an incredible example that I would offer more people should be using around the world. There are several really good studies that have been done on the BC carbon tax. I feel weird even talking about the BC carbon tax. I'm going to hand the microphone over to the man who designed it in a minute. But I will say, because I know politics and communications more than policy design, that we're not talking enough globally about how the GDP has not fallen. In fact, it's stronger than almost any other province in British Columbia, yet emissions have gone down. We've stimulated innovation. The carbon tax worked in BC. We have 8 years of data. It stopped working when the premier refused to continue to increase it. So she froze it, our premier that we have right now, and the result is that emissions started going up again. And we've started to see flight of clean tech and high tech because they don't have the certainty that a stepwise approach on a carbon tax. So hopefully that will be unfrozen soon with a national climate plan. But the fact is the sky didn't fall. But in Alberta culturally is just so different from BC that model didn't matter as much. I would say if there's one thing I can point to that mattered, it would be the work of the Ecofiscal Commission in Canada in working with conservatives. And so you had conservatives and folks from the right and business leaders talking about how good a carbon tax was for stimulating innovation and stimulating the economy. And we needed that to reach people in Alberta, for them to consider a tax wasn't just going to be something that would hurt businesses.
Thank you. We have to come to a close. I don't know if Mark wants to say something.
Just very quick, just to add on the sort of Norway-Canadian or Albertan comparison, so Norway, I don't know how it breaks out regionally, but I know the oil is off the coast, whereas in Canada there is enormous regional diversity in ideology and favorable, you know, thoughts about how we ought to act on climate change. And so even right now we have Ontario and Quebec that have joined California's cap and trade system. So we've now got, about 60 million North Americans under a cap and trade that covers transportation as well. So I don't think the European cap and trade has even gotten to that yet. And we had 9 dark years of government that was by someone who was elected in Alberta and is very conservative and was able to get a majority government because we have the British first past the post system. He never got more than 39% of the vote, and the 60 to 61% of the other people voting for the other parties were all part of the Greens, a Quebec party, the Liberal Party, and the Social Democrats, who were all very strong for climate policy. So in a way, Canada's kind of floated back again. That the Alberta government should be like that is quite fascinating, and I think Tzeporah is able to explain a lot of that, but I just wanted to point out that regional aspect. The last part is, of course, you can talk a long time about climate policy preferences. We know it has to be effective policy, and effective policy has to be some kind of price or an implicit price from some kind of regulations. And ironically, when the premier and his deputy minister, and it was really the deputy minister that I worked with, Graham Whitmarsh, came to me and said, we want to do a carbon tax, I said, are you sure you want to do that? Because I've been around people who are, you know, political scientists who will say, will this backfire? Will it have staying power? Will it keep growing over time? Will you get unelected, as may happen to the Alberta government in a couple of years because of its carbon tax? So I'm not someone who says it's got to be the carbon tax just because I'm an economist and I want everyone to listen to me. I'm willing to take a bit of an economic hit to put in policies that might be flexible but regulatory and might not be that much inefficient compared to a carbon tax, like the vehicle emissions, the flexible vehicle emission standards in California, a renewable portfolio standard. So we do a lot of research on what is the efficiency hit of doing things that might score way higher in be way less troubling than a carbon tax for a politician. Because basically, British Columbia put in that carbon tax, it was 11 or 10 years ago now, and no one's really followed us until Alberta is trying to do it right now. But we can talk for a long time on climate policy, and that's not the point.
Okay, thank you very much. We have to...